the work that I'm best known for is this work that was involved in the discovery of the rapid antidepressant effects of ketamine. Most people probably have heard of chemicals like norepinephrine and serotonin. These are the chemicals in the brain that are targeted by drugs like Prozac, which raise the level of serotonin in the brain. Our collaborative group did a study where they depleted the brain and body of serotonin and norepinephrine in healthy people, and they didn't get depressed. And this raised a really interesting question for us, which is, what if serotonin and norepinephrine are chemical systems in the brain that can be recruited by antidepressant medications to help alleviate depression? If we probed the biology of those systems, of the glutamate systems, then we might learn something important about the biology of depression. Ketamine blocks one of the receptor targets for glutamate in the brain called the NMDA glutamate receptor. And what we found, as everybody who's familiar with ketamine knows now, was that ketamine produced some rapid effects when we administered it. People felt a little woozy, a little dissociated, had some subjective symptoms of euphoria and other kinds of symptoms. And those symptoms went away within about 2 hours. And then starting at about 3 or 4 hours after that, people started to feel a little lighter. And then 24 hours after the first dose, a number of the people that were depressed patients who were participating in our study really felt remarkably better, in some cases, all better. And this was completely shocking to us. The idea up until that point, this was probably 1996 or so that we started doing this study. And until that point, all antidepressant medications took months, weeks to months of daily medication treatment to produce the kind of improvements that we saw in this first style within hours of the first dose. And the data were so shocking to us that we didn't have a great deal of confidence that they were true when we first saw them. And so it was really helpful, and this is something that's very common in science, which is you make an observation, and then the first replication really gives you much more confidence. They did the first replication of our initial observation, and you could practically superimpose their data on what we saw.
What you're proposing here is a completely different level of neurotransmitter, not just a neurotransmitter system that's different, but a different level, if it's proven, and there seems to be strong evidence for this. This is a monumental breakthrough in psychiatry and neuroscience that we haven't seen in a while, isn't it?
Yeah, absolutely. The first generation of antidepressant medications, upon which all current antidepressant medications were derived, they were all discovered in 1957 or earlier. And since that time, all the treatments for depression have been following the footsteps, using the same mechanisms, targeting norepinephrine and serotonin and dopamine. Ketamine is the first mechanistically novel antidepressant approved by the FDA in something like 50 years. So it really is a profoundly different take on how you could target the biology of depression. And, you know, it's interesting to me, Dean, that your interests in neurodegenerative disorders converge with some new ideas that we have about the biology of depression. Historically, people would say depression, that's a functional disorder. That's what happens if you're not thinking straight. But the more that we understand about stress and depression and how they affect the brain, for example, if you do PET scans to look at the availability of the synaptic connections between nerve cells, with positron emission tomography now, we can actually show in depressed patients who have deficits in their synaptic density, 24 hours after a single dose of ketamine, these people not only are feeling better in terms of their depression, but the degree to which they improve is related to the increase in synaptic density that you see after a dose of ketamine. So ketamine is really, at least in the data that we have so far, enabling the brain to reconnect. For some people, the single dose of ketamine will produce only a relatively brief improvement of 3 or 4 days, so that you need to, at the start of treatment, repeat the dosing a couple of times a week in order to make sure people don't have a dip in their mood between doses. But even from that first dose, some people will have an improvement in mood that lasts 2 weeks or even longer.
the relationship with neurodegenerative diseases are so powerful. In Parkinson's, one of the strongest non-motor signs, early signs, is depression. Even when you control for all the other variables, depression seems to be one of the strongest early markers of that. And of course, with Alzheimer's and other dementias as well. So I definitely think that this is a breakthrough. Of course, we need to know more. We need to learn more. A question I have is the treatment and the poison is in the dose. How confident are we as far as our knowledge of the dosing of this drug?
I'm glad you brought it up because the issue related to dose is connected to different ways in which people have been prescribing ketamine and esketamine and the risk of misuse of ketamine, recreational use of ketamine. The standard antidepressant dose of ketamine is 0.5, 0.5 mg per kilogram, administered over a 40-minute intravenous infusion. If you go too low, in other words, if you cut the dose by half, there are three studies that show for depression and for PTSD that 0.2 mg per kilogram given over the same way is not effective for treating depression. If you go higher from 0.5 mg per kilogram to 1.0 mg per kilogram, what you see is that the dissociative, the perception changes, the thought alterations that you get with ketamine become much more intense. But there's not empirical evidence in a randomized controlled trial that going from 0.5 to 1.0 increases the response on average in these groups of patients that have been studied. So 0.5 mg per kilogram looks like it's a sweet spot. When you go to an anesthetic dose, more like 2 to 3 mg per kilogram, in other words, 4 to 6 times the therapeutic dose, ketamine is an anesthetic drug. And when it's an anesthetic drug, it is not an antidepressant drug. It is not antidepressant at the anesthetic dose. One of the concerning things about those low doses, because they're generally safe and tolerable, is that sometimes doctors are prescribing those doses for use at home. And therein gets to be a potential problem for some people, because they're taking ketamine to feel better, but their depression isn't getting better. They feel a little bit less anxiety when the ketamine is in their body, but when the ketamine washes out of their body, they lose that beneficial effect. And they're not getting the antidepressant effect. Having ketamine to use at home, particularly if you're using low doses that are too low to be effective for your depression, can set people up to develop ketamine misuse or ketamine addiction problem. And that's something that we have to be very concerned about.
So now to the big question, side effects. What are the side effects that you see that people should be concerned about when talking about ketamine?
Yeah, let's separate the side effects during the session and after the session. So during the session, the main side effect that carries medical risk is that ketamine briefly raises your blood pressure about as much as walking up a flight of stairs, so about 10, 15 millimeters of mercury. That's fine if your blood pressure is in good shape before you get your ketamine administration, but it's something that we pay attention to if someone has high blood pressure. There are other side effects of ketamine that get a lot more attention, and those I would call the dissociative or psychotogenic effects of ketamine, which is that when ketamine is in your body at a therapeutic dose, when you get this 40-minute infusion, the last 10, 20 minutes of that infusion, and then the 20 minutes or so after the infusion is completed, people will have alterations in perception of their environment. In other words, the walls may breathe in and out, lights may be brighter or darker, sounds may be coming from places that they don't expect, experience of pain or other sensations may be altered. They may have some unusual beliefs that pop up or some sense of the K-hole. The K-hole is this very interesting thing that happens for some people where they can detect and respond to stimuli in the middle of their visual fields, but in the periphery of their visual fields, things get darker or blurry or things like that. And so they have an altered kind of perception of the environment around them. If you know what's going on and if you're prepared for that experience, and if there are people with you to remind you what's happening, you hardly ever need to do anything other than just support people through the event. The thing that's probably most dangerous for some people who are using at home, and the thing we worry the most about, is the addiction vulnerability. We're all aware of the story of Matthew Perry, and for every Matthew Perry that you know about, there are many people who have had similar kinds of problems that you don't know about. And so that's why we limit ketamine and S-ketamine treatment to the clinic so people don't misuse the medication and develop bad ketamine-related habits.